which time we will vote on the applications. You may stay and hear how the applications are decided, or you may leave following the hearing. The applicant and the town board will be sent a copy of tonight's decisions. Any other person wishing to receive a copy of a decision can sign the sheet on the table in the front of the room. Those of you wishing immediately knowledge of the outcome of these proceedings may call the zoning office tomorrow morning. The procedure will be as follows. After each applicant is read, the applicant, their agent, or representative will be asked to present the application, followed by any questions or comments from the committee. Then all correspondence will be read. Then others in favor will have a chance to speak. Anyone objecting will then have a chance to speak. I will then ask for a summary of the committee's field observations and staff comments. Finally, the applicant will be allowed for a chance for a short rebuttal if they wish. Anyone wishing to speak, use the microphone, state your name, and direct your comments to the committee. Because of the number of applications tonight, I'm asking that all testimony be kept brief and to the point. The applicant will have 5 minutes to present information on their application other than questions from the committee. Anyone else wishing to speak should limit their testimony to 3 minutes, and any rebuttal by the applicant will also be limited to 3 minutes. If you are testifying as a nearby landowner, please tell us where your property is located relative to the subject property. Tonight's hearing will be recorded, and recording will become part of the record. Comments based on hearsay or secondhand information, as well as slanderous and prejudicial remarks, will be ruled out of order. The committee has looked at all the properties, and the record will reflect their observations. Any person affected by an administrative decision of the committee has 10 days from the filing of tonight's decision to make an appeal. Such appeals are heard by the Board of Adjustments. Information and applications are available from the zoning office. The county assumes no liability, makes no warranty as to the legality of any construction commenced to the expiration of the 10-day period. I will now introduce the committee to our very, very far left, Rusowski, our corp counsel, Jerry Rathmel, Fred Gallerup, Donna Collada, County Board Chair, Bob Wadle, Terry Dot Pockstead, Zoning Administrator. My name is Mark Kirshner. Conditional use, the first application that we will hear tonight. Thomas and Victoria Drury, Red Granite, Wisconsin, have made application for a conditional use in accordance with sections 58-236, paragraph 18, and 58-454, paragraph 31 of the Washera County Zoning Code to store a 1991 Sportsman 30-foot travel trailer in an AG5 general agricultural zone 5-acre minimum lot size. Location, an approximate 20-acre parcel of land known as the south half of the northwest quarter of the southeast quarter, section 34, town 20 north, range 10 east, town of Rose, fire number N5051, 17th Bend. Is the applicant present? Would you come forward, please? Would you state your name for the record, please, Thomas?
Thomas Dreyer.
Thomas, can you tell us a little bit what your plans are or what you want to do after
this? We use the land for recreational purposes. We've planted 9,000 trees. We're improving the property. We just use it to stay out there when we're out there.
Okay. Committee questions, please.
Some of these we asked you when they were out there, but we have to do it for the record. Has there been a recent survey of the property?
When I bought it 10 years ago.
Okay. And then you're sure where your lot lines are exactly?
Yes, in fact, the lot line to the south was just surveyed again because they sold that property off. Okay. And the stakes were awful close to where the original ones were, so they wasted a lot of money.
Okay. Is this trailer licensed and roadworthy?
Yes, it is.
If an approval is granted, will the trailer be located? Will the trailer be at least 100 feet from all lot lines?
When the committee came out, I showed them where I would move that trailer to. Right now, it is not. due to some circumstances that worked out kind of wrong. And it will be moved in the spring when I can dig dirt and lay another concrete slab.
The trailer is not visible from a public road, correct?
No, not at all.
That road is private drag?
Private road.
What about the neighboring properties? Are they aware of it or worried about it? Or?
Well, the one's a 120 acre cornfield, and the other side is 30 acres of woods, and they don't have a house there or anything. So no one can see it from any...
Have you talked to the neighbors about this? Or?
No, I have not. The one neighbor's brand new. I haven't even met him.
Okay. Have you discussed this with the town board?
Yes, I did call.
And what was their...
They said if you could see it from a main road, they may have objections.
Yeah.
And I told them that we're 3/4 mile off the road, and he said we would have no problems.
Okay. Will there be running water out there?
I have running water, but I do not hook it up to the trailer due to the fact that I did at one time. It's such a problem to blow the lines out and all that. We don't do it. If you want water, turn it on and get a bucket.
Okay. What type of sanitary facilities are planning other than what is in the trailer?
I have a composting toilet.
Are there any other buildings or structures being planned at this time?
No.
We noticed a fairly new small shed on our property. Did you get a land use permit for that shed?
The one farther down?
I believe so.
That is a pump house, and that was there when I bought the property. All I did is put new siding on it because it was deteriorating and the floor kept rotting, and that's where the water pump and the well is right outside, and all I did is put some different siding on so it wouldn't keep rotting out.
You did a good job. I thought it was new.
No kidding.
Looked new.
Fooled us. We thought
it
was new.
That siding is actually off an old pole barn from a hail damage, and I just reused it.
Are there similar travel trailers in the area?
Some people own one way up at the other end of the road, and I don't know those guys. They only come up once in a while. I don't know them.
Okay. Once you get this travel trailer relocated, will a new driveway be necessary, or can you use the existing?
Use the existing because I can pull up right by the pole barn.
Are you going to change the existing driveway at all, or?
Not at all.
Is this property in the managed forest law?
No, it's not.
You had mentioned that there was an old mobile home here and that it was replaced by an old travel trailer. Was there ever a septic system to that trailer?
There is a septic system. Unfortunately, when the guy put the mobile home in, the previous owner who was selling it to him under a land contract, Jim Flagner, he told them, don't put a septic system in until I have it surveyed. Well, he did. That septic system is on Erickson's cornfield.
So it's
on the other side of the easement off the property, and it's been abandoned. I went around and around with zoning a couple times because I kept getting the notice to have it pumped. I said I would gladly have it pumped if it belonged to me. It would improve my property. It does not. It's in a cornfield.
If an approval is granted, when would you relocate the trailer?
This spring, as soon as I can do something when the weather permits.
Okay. That's all the questions I have, Mr. Chairman.
Any other committee questions? Jerry or Fred? Donna?
Nope. No.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Correspondence, please.
We have no correspondence and no one registered to speak.
Staff comments, please.
For the record, the committee has previously been furnished with a copy of the site plan and all the other data for this and the other conditional use that they'll be considering tonight. And at this time, I'd like to explain a little bit about conditional use permits. All defined zones have uses that are permitted outright, such as building a home in the residential zone or having a barn and farm animals in the agricultural zone. In addition, there are uses that may be permitted provided certain conditions are met, and this is what we're looking at here. A use that may be permitted provided that certain parameters can be complied with, so the use remains in keeping with the surrounding uses and area. Some examples of this is like a dog kennel, the unoccupied storage of a travel trailer on vacant property, a gravel pit, or a home-based business in our rural areas. In some counties, these permits are called special exception permits. There are guidelines for travel trailer placement, needs to be kept licensed and roadworthy, no permanent additions, must have sanitary facilities other than what's in the unit, must be 100 feet from all lot lines. it's the landowner's responsibility to provide the information that shows the committee this use is still in keeping with the zone and area it is proposed for, and that the conditions placed on it will ensure it will be a good neighbor to the surrounding landowners. When the committee visited the property, they noted that the trailer could be relocated to comply with the required setbacks, and that it would definitely not be visible from the public road. That's it for my comments. I think so.
Okay, that concludes the first conditional use. The next conditional use that we'll be hearing tonight, George O. Edgreen IV, Wild Rose, Wisconsin, has made application for a conditional use in accordance with sections 58-236, paragraph 22 of the Washera County Zoning Code to establish a home-based business, including retail sales of metal yard art and minor custom metal fabrication and repair in the AG General Agricultural Zone within the shoreland area. Location, an approximate 1 acre parcel of land being located in the southwest portion of Government Lot 1, Section 26, Town 20 North, Range 11 East, Town of Springwater, fire number W5668, Archer Lane. Is the applicant present? Would you come forward, please? State your name for the record, please.
George Edgren.
Can you kind of tell us what you're going to do, or what you want to do, or what you are doing and have been doing? And it's kind of unique.
Yeah. For the most part, I mainly just build metal art, but it's metal fabrication in general. Anything oddball. I actually did a job for Washera County Ambulance just maybe a couple weeks ago, actually. My plans are to build another storage building for materials, but for the most part, it's kind of a as-is sort of deal. I don't really plan on. Like large numbers of many parts. Like, I'm not an assembly line of machinists or welders. It's a one-man crew thing. It's always going to stay that way. I don't like to work with other people.
Just yourself.
Yeah.
Okay. The committee's got a few questions they're going to ask you. Some of them will be repetition that we asked you when we were out there. So, committee questions, please.
Yes. Has there been a recent survey?
Not since I moved in about 5 or 6 years ago.
Do you know where the lot lines are?
Yes.
Is the, wait, I have the wrong one here. All right. If an approval is granted, let's see. I don't think I have the right ones. Okay, I'm sorry. I'm new here. I don't usually do zoning. Sorry. All right. Could you describe your proposed business in more detail?
Like what you'd like to know, maybe?
Well, we pretty much know that you're doing yard art,
mm-hmm.
And then you do some work for, you know, as requested, like for our EMS. And
yeah, it's one of those things where if you come up to the door and you ask me to make something custom for you, I do. I've done some work on cats. I actually had the guys taking down all the trees for the power lines. They actually broke some of the equipment just down the road, so then they pop up, and now I kind of have another customer just through them, just because there's an oddball freak accident, and then like, oh, well, obviously you can weld. Hey, can you fix this equipment? I'm like, yeah, next thing you know, they're off on their way in. I've done a little bit of everything. I've had people with four-wheelers that broke down, that, you know, something broke on it, and I tear it apart, fix it, and weld it back up, and send them on their way. It's pretty much anything that's metal-related that I can repair is what I do. But I like to stick to art, but, you know, anything really. Kind of one of those pays-the-bills sort of things.
Okay, thank you. Will there be any employees outside your immediate family? Okay. What sort of traffic will there be, and what sort of parking will you need?
I think the traffic is as bad as it will ever be, kind of thing. I don't think we'll ever really get worse. And mainly it's the campers when they're coming in and when they're stuff when they come in, like, oh, we gotta check it out while we're camping, and then they'll come down in their afternoons and then oftentimes buy stuff or they just wander around. And I don't really think it's that bad from the norm from when I moved in. It's just more people stop. And as far as parking goes, that's kind of an up in the air sort of thing. I believe I spoke with you when you came out about pushing some of my metal art back further so they have more room on the, you know, actual lawn area for a little bit safer. But, you know, there's always parking in the driveway. I usually keep it open in the summer just so people can park. But I think most people are weird about it. Like, oh, well, this is this guy's house. I don't want to park in his driveway. But other people aren't, and they'll just pull right in and start browsing.
Thank you. Will there be parking along the town road then?
I guess that kind of depends on you guys. I didn't really want to stick a parking lot in there and then have you guys tell me I can't have people parking in my property, that it's not right, so I never designated a spot for it, but there could be.
Do you think it would be possible to move the items back from the edge of the road and the concrete parking pad along the edge of the road for approximately 10 to 15 feet?
I can move the metal art 10 to 15 feet. I can't really move the parking pad, though. That's not really my... That was there when I moved in, like, 6 years ago. I think it's been there for almost 20 or 30 years now.
Is an advertising sign planned?
Advertising sign? I actually have like one or two. They're not very big. I'm pretty small.
Are you aware of the state building codes and other state requirements that may be necessary with employees or the public entering buildings, and will they be met?
I'm not up to code on those, but I never have people. I don't have a storefront. It's outside.
What sort of sanitary facilities are you planning?
You mean like restrooms? I guess I never really thought about it. Just because it's an outdoor thing, I never really... To be honest with you, I never really thought about that one. I never thought about people stopping to use a bathroom, but if they needed it, I just let them use the house.
Right.
I'm not rude about it.
Okay. And you said you are planning new buildings?
It would just be a pole shed for storage, mainly just like almost everybody's seen the transformer that I built, and I wasn't very happy with it because I had a parted out car in my driveway for about 2 months while I was building it, and it wasn't very becoming, and then this way I'll have space to dismantle things and nobody's really got to see a parted out Suburban or whatever it is in my driveway. But other than a pole building for more storage, it's...
It's pretty awesome transformer.
Thank you.
That's nice. Hey, will you be working out of the new building?
Minimally, but it's possible.
Where will you store your materials for making the yard art? And I think you just told us that in that new building. Where do you get all of your materials?
Honestly, a little bit everywhere. Like recently, I just inherited my grandfather's old junk collection, so I've got quite a decent amount of scrap from there. But before that, I would sometimes people will just bring them by the, you know, local customers or whatever, and they'll just drop off random old pots and pans or whatever they had, and then they can make stuff out of that. Sometimes I'll actually go to a scrap yard, but it's very rare. Usually, it's I go to St. Vince. Then I buy raw materials actually through like a metal wholesaler kind of thing.
Are there any floor drains planned in the new or existing buildings? And if so, how will these wastes be disposed of?
Well, as a pole building, there's just going to be a gravel floor, but I don't really see waste going anywhere.
Are any other additions or buildings planned other than what you've indicated on the site plan?
No, other than the possible lean-to that was thought of, but like other than that, I don't, and that was just a thought, but that would be way further down the line. That's something that would probably be discussed later.
Will all work be conducted inside and only finished yard art for sale stored on the outside?
Yeah, I mean, there's, I try to keep it to a minimum of my debris that's outside, but I mean, there's a certain point where if it's something larger, I have to obviously bring tools and equipment and metal outside and then to build it. And sometimes it can be a lengthier process, but usually it's not something that's going to be dwelling for a very long period of time, especially because I'm weird about my yard. And like the first transformer, I wanted to get the car gone ASAP because people thought their kids could play in it. And we taped it off, we did everything possible, and like people don't control their children, and I don't like having my stuff outside just because of that reason alone. So yeah, another pole building would be the ideal thing for me, so I don't have to have that stuff outside because I'm very weird about it.
Thank you. Let's see. Are you planning on a new driveway?
No. I actually have a little, it looks kind of like a driveway, but it's not. It's just a little sand driveway type of thing. It's not really a driveway. It's like a little route around the house that's just kind of grown in from us using it throughout the years, but it's not really a driveway. I think you've seen it.
Do you need a separate fire number for the business?
I don't believe I would.
If an approval is granted, when would you make any improvements necessary?
Well, I've been working on it pretty much constantly since I've got the notice from you guys, and from everybody that stopped, it's an ongoing thing. I'm never really going to stop working on it. It's my business, and I'm going to keep chucking away on it.
And then the last question is, when we pretty much already know your business is already operating. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Correspondence?
Yes, on November 10th, Everett Eckstein, the town chair for the town of Springwater, called and left a message on my voicemail. And he stated that the town board had discussed Edgren's conditional use permit at the previous night's town board meeting. And while they did not take an official vote on the application, it was the consensus of the board that they did not have issues with this application. And he went on to say that they felt it was a good cottage industry and that this particular business would fit in with the neighborhood and the town. And again, that was on November 10th. That same day, we got a letter via email. It says, good morning. I would like to express my concerns about the special use permit for Edgren Yard Art and am unable to attend the meeting about this application. Archer Lane is a very narrow and heavily traveled residential road that is in very poor condition. I have witnessed many close calls with traffic stopping in the middle of Archer Lane to view the yard art. Mr. Edgren's property is located on a sharp curve from one direction, and there is a hill in the other direction which provides poor visibility for drivers to see stopped vehicles until they are very close to them. When you add the normal summer traffic, campers, motorhomes, bike traffic, walkers, cars, etc., with people stopping in the middle of the road, it creates a very dangerous situation. Mr. Edgren offers no customer parking, so people are forced to park on the small shoulder of Archer Lane. Most of the times, there are cars parked half on Archer and half on the shoulder, since there is not enough of a shoulder to safely park. Mr. Edgren does have a driveway, however, he has it full of his art and can't even fit his own vehicles in his driveway and ends up parking on the shoulder as well. Also, the Edgren family is in the process of applying for a zone change for another piece of property further down Archer Lane near Evergreen Campsites and Resort to build commercial storage units. Currently, this property is agricultural. I am not sure why the county would consider doing these zone changes when this is promoting spot zoning. Spot zoning is something we should be trying to get away from. I would strongly consider holding off on the approval of the permit for Edgren Yard Art until the family has a proposal in place for the storage buildings as well. It would make more sense for the county to consider doing a zone change so the storage buildings and the lawn art could be together with adequate room for a parking lot to prevent people from parking on Archer Lane. Maybe the Edgrens should consider leaving the yard art where it is currently, adding a parking lot, and building the storage units on the piece of property. In the town board meetings, the Edgren family brought up concerns about people trespassing around the storage buildings. If they were built on the site where the yard art is, at least the family could keep an eye on the buildings and provide better security for them. I also know the family has access to this property off of 24th Avenue and County Road A. They could build a new facility off of County Road A where it won't be in the middle of residential and agricultural land. Please assist the Edgren family with coming up with a plan that would combine these commercial spaces together in a safer place and have the properties be with other like properties away from residential homes. I am not against them trying to create, operate these businesses. However, Archer Lane, in my opinion, is not the correct place for them. And that says, thank you, Jeremy Gabory, G-A-B-O-U-R-Y. And that's it for correspondence. No one registered to speak.
No one registered in favor or opposition to speak. Staff comments, please.
Again, the committee has been furnished with a copy of the site plan and all the other data for this application. It's another conditional use in the agricultural zone. It's a use that may be permitted provided certain conditions are met. When the committee visited the property, they noted that there may be parking problems if cars are parked on the narrow town road, that items should be moved back out of the road right away, and that materials gathered but not yet used for the yard art should be kept inside a building or behind a solid fence. And I would also remind the committee that really you're only looking at the conditional use application tonight. Anything else that they may have planned has not come before this committee, so it's really not part of this. This is just the conditional use for the yard art. So that's it for my comments.
Is there anything the applicant would like to add? Yes.
For the most part, I understand that it's a narrow road, but what is not mentioned is it is a very large driveway for whom has actually come out, and it's, I do park in my own driveway, but it is very long, and I usually park way at the end towards the transformer off to the side. There almost always is room to park in it, and as far as the narrow road thing, it is narrow, but there's actually a lot of room on the side to park. It's not like there's trees that are hugging the road line. There's actually quite, like 8 feet usually on the far side. I'm not on my property, but then on my side, I actually have the concrete slabs, which I'd obviously pull the yard art back further. But I can't prevent every person from stopping in the road. It's not, it's ignorant in my, you know, opinion, but I can't really stop it. And I've actually told people before that stopped and started talking, like, hey, can you please pull over? There's cars coming. But I can only do what I can. And we've actually discussed putting up a parking sign so people would hopefully pull over. But it's a lot of people speeding down that road as well. It's a constant whenever I have people over, they're like, wow, they're not going 25 miles an hour. And that's, if you're speeding around that tiny little corner and you rear end a vehicle, parked or not, it's your fault for driving into the rear end of somebody else's vehicle. Pretty much my opinion on that. I mean, I do what I can, but I only can do so much.
Okay. All right, thank you again. Okay, the next application that we'll hear tonight is a zone change. Not a conditional use, a zone change. Lisa A. Rosenthal, Red Granite, Wisconsin, has made application for a zone change in accordance with sections 58-131 through 138-58-236, paragraph 6, and 58-784, paragraph 23 of the Washera County Zoning Code from an AG, General Agricultural, to an MI, Intensive Manufacturing, to conditionally establish a salvage yard. Variance for setbacks pending by the Board of Adjustments consideration. Utilizing an existing 18-foot 3-inch by 32-6-inch barn and a 32 by 120 pole building. Location an approximate 200 feet east and west by 240 feet north and south portion of an existing 1.86-acre parcel of land known as Lot 1 of Certified Survey Map 4825, being part of the northeast quarter of the northeast quarter, section 21, town 19 north, range 12 east, Town of Leola, fire number N3693, County Road E. Applicant present? Town of Leon, pardon me. I'm used to Adams County, that's why I respond out there all the time, that's why. Ruth knows that, I do that all the time. Can you state a few things for us, what you're gonna do out there?
Sure. Actually, my married, that's my maiden name, but my married name's Lisa McClellan. We're gonna kinda, you guys don't know, but we've been doing it for 10 years. We go and we collect recyclable scrap items from people, bring them to our house. If we have to sort them, you know, and process them, we sort them, process them, we take them to another recycling center. That's, you know, pretty much.
Basically it.
Yeah, basically all we do.
Okay. The committee has some questions that they would wanna ask you. Robert?
Has there been a recent survey and you, and do you know exactly where your lot lines are?
There hasn't been a recent survey, but we know where they are.
You pretty much described, but is there anything else you can tell us about your operation?
We're gonna be open by appointment only, so it's not like we're gonna have traffic, you know, tons of traffic in and out. Obviously, if people wanna, you know, say they have something and they wanna drop it off, so be it. But most of the time, we go get it and bring it back.
Exactly what kinds of salvageable materials do you take in at the present time? Okay.
We don't accept tires, cars, appliances I charge for, televisions I charge for, computers I charge for. I do not accept aluminum cans unless it's for Girl Scouts or Boy Scouts or something like that. That's the only way I would accept aluminum cans. And otherwise, we accept anything else that's recyclable, except for cardboard.
How long have you been operating this business? I believe you said 10 years, is that? Okay. What do you do to separate the salvageable materials and ready them for transport to another facility or for a final sale?
Most of the time it's hand sort, sometimes it's sorted with a skid loader or tractor loader. You know, if it's too heavy to lift, you need something to lift it with.
You don't cut anything up?
Yes, if we need to cut something apart, I use a torch or a German saw or cutoff saw. You know.
How many employees do you anticipate you will have when fully operational?
We
don't really have employees. If we do hire somebody, it's for trucking. We have them haul for us.
What sort of traffic do you anticipate? For example, how many people will stop by or trucks pull in or autos be there to be dismantled per week?
Autos? There should be no autos there at all because we don't accept them. If I do accept them, it's for the fire department to practice on.
So there wouldn't be any, on a regular basis, then any automobiles there? Okay. Do you plan to do any sales such as parts from salvage automobiles, farm equipment, tractors or trucks?
Farm equipment, I will part out. Tractors, I very seldom get them to part out. Cars and trucks, no.
Are you planning any signs for advertising your business being there? Okay. Are you planning to build and maintain a suitable fencing around the property? Will the driveways be altered, or are you putting in new or closing any of the existing driveways?
I would like to close the existing driveway and move the driveway, but I have not talked to the highway commissioner about that yet. If that is not possible, I'd like to at least widen the driveway that is there.
That was the next question would be if you've talked to the highway department. What about permits from the DOT for the salvage operation?
For what I am handling, I do not need salvage license, scavenger license, or anything like that.
You said any other machinery used, like a shear or anything for disassembling the materials or scrapping them? Just a torch, you cut them if need be? Okay. does any of this, for anybody that's not familiar with a torch, that, does that make a lot of noise? Or the salvaging operation, will you be making a lot of noise that?
There could be possibly noise, yes, you know, stuff falls apart, if you're loading something and it drops.
Tractors, you know, your equipment, normal noise.
Are you aware of the state licensing and requirements that are necessary, and do you currently have any of those?
State licensing for salvage, I do not have, but I'm aware of them.
How do you plan to deal with any stormwater runoff from the area? In case there was some battery acid or radiator antifreeze or something, or?
That stuff would be all contained in a concrete slab without a drain. And for battery acid, you have lime,
okay,
to soak it up. And radiator fluid or motor oil, you have floor drag.
Are there any chemicals that will be stored in association with this operation? And if you are you aware of any permits and restrictions for storing any of those?
Well, there should not be any chemicals.
How will you keep the machinery, autos, and other vehicles or appliances from leaking onto the ground if somebody brings them in there and they're leaking or what have you?
If that happens, I'll have to clean the appliances up immediately and clean up the mess immediately.
And if there is like some Freon or something that's toxic or hazardous, how will you dispose of that?
I would have to find a Freon recycler and pay to get rid of it.
Have you talked with the local fire chief and know if there's any requirements that they may have?
Yes.
What sort of sanitary facilities are you planning for if people come in there and?
For now, we're thinking porta potties.
Are there any other additions or buildings planned other than what you've indicated that you used on the site plan right now?
Nothing.
Will you be bringing in any new equipment such as like a compressor, or compactor or something for the metal, or is it all too small? Okay. Have you checked with the building inspector to see if there are any approvals that you may need to meet with the state building codes?
Because I don't really have employees that aren't really working in the shed, he wasn't quite sure on how we were going to handle it.
So you have been in contact?
Yeah, I called him and he said, you know, we'd have to kind of see what happened.
Okay. And are you aware of the setbacks that are required in the code, and will these be met?
I know them, and no, I will not meet them. I filed for a variance.
And you are currently salvaging materials, is that correct?
Not since June 22nd, but we were before that.
That's all the questions I have, Mr. Chairman.
I have a question.
Yes, Donna.
What are your hours of operation?
Well, we really don't have hours. We'll
uh-huh.
meet the noise ordinance, you know, your 7 a.m. to 10 p.m., but it's by appointment only, so we really don't, you know, we're not going to sit there from 8 to 5 Monday through Friday, or, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm more concerned with, you know, the 5 to 10, you know, that. Will you be doing a lot of your business during then, you know, 5 o'clock in the afternoon?
It depends on the time of the year, if we're busy, if we're not busy. It, with us, we can be really busy one week, and we can be doing nothing the next week. It's not a constant business.
Right. And when you take in, you said you take in TVs and appliances. Do you do computers, too?
Yes.
Okay. And where is your outlet for those?
State off.
Say that again.
State off.
Okay, all right, thank you. Those are the only questions I have.
Ruth?
I just need Mr. McClellan to state his name for the record so that we have it.
David McClellan.
Thank you.
And can I ask a couple? I don't think the traffic was quite stated. We got sidetracked there. How many trucks would you think you're gonna have in a week, or?
One week,
was that
probably
one?
Could have 20 trucks next week. We might have none. You know, it's hard to say.
Be very sporadic then.
A lot of times, most of the traffic people want to stop and shoot the shit. You know.
And then had stated when we were out there that your hours of operation, because you're both working, tended to be a lot of evenings, the 5 to 10, like you had said, or whatever?
Yes, it all depends on what I have to ship and if I want to ship it. If the market's right there and I want to move it, we're going to load it and move it. And, you know, it all depends on that. Most of the work is going to be done on weekends. Evenings we do most of the pickups and bring the stuff in.
So I think you had said 5 to 10 p.m. during the week and then noon till 10 p.m. on Saturday and all day Sunday?
Well, if we were going to have open hours, that was going to be open hours on, you know, for the public, but we're just going to go by appointment only. So Saturdays would probably be from like 8 o'clock in the morning until 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon. And Sunday's probably similar hours.
And then there are some DNR permits that are required too. You're aware of those?
I talked to the DNR. They didn't state anything. Because I don't deal with cars, so I don't have all the chemicals or whatever on the property.
I think I've got a letter here that says something a little different, but I'll read it.
Okay.
That's it. I'm done.
Any other questions? Ruth, Jerry, Brett, Donna?
Nope.
Robert?
Nope.
Okay, thank you. Correspondence, please.
On October 30th, I talked to Chris Sorensen, the chairman for the town of Leon. I wanted to make sure that he knew about the relationship between the town's land use plan and decisions of the county planning and zoning committee. And as it stands, the town's land use plan does not note that this area is slated for future manufacturing, industrial, or commercial development. And if the planning and zoning committee were to make a recommendation to approve this application, it would not be in compliance with the town or county land use plan. And he told me that the town's planning commission was not currently active because some of the original members had either passed away or moved away. And in order to get it fully populated and organized, the town would need some time to do that. He also noted that the town had not taken an official position on the application, but that he had some personal reservations about the application being located so close to the residential area across the street. In addition, he felt that there were issues with the variances to the setbacks that could be difficult to overcome. He is planning to bring it up at the November town board meeting and will let me know if the town board takes an official position. And I would note that he has not called me since the November town board meeting, so they must have not taken an official position. Then we have quite a few emails from several people in DNR. There was Brad Wolbert, who says, I'm not aware that the DNR has any regulatory interest in the matter of a zoning change for a proposed salvage yard. Salvage yards are not considered solid waste facilities under Wisconsin law, so he's the solid waste guy at DNR. Another person was out of the office until November 16th. And from Tony Fisher, the only issue is for her to apply for an appropriate permit with the DNR that would eventually be forwarded to me. Any issues would be worked out before I can convey coverage. Depending on what they intend to do, the one thing that could be a bit of an issue is petroleum products leaking into the soil. But if they follow the permit, that concern is minimized. A lot of questions will be answered when they tell through a permit application how they intend to operate their site. And thanks for letting me know about this, though, and that's signed Anthony Fisher. Week of November 2nd through the 6th, Lindsay spoke with Craig Stemler from the Wisconsin DNR Intermanagement Program, and Craig asked to get a phone number for Lisa. Craig wanted to contact her and speak with her about a potential permit for car salvaging, especially related to air conditioning systems because they can emit toxic gases and need to be dismantled properly. So Lindsay provided that. Then on November 16th, we got a letter from Jim Angelo. During a recent visit and walkthrough of the David and Lisa McClellan property, specifically the area that if approved will be designated scrap iron storage area and a torching area to be used to cut up scrap iron for salvage, David, Lisa, and I discussed their plan for the perimeter storage area, which would include a fenced-in enclosure and the specific area where most of the torching of scrap iron will take place. In my opinion, with the proper procedures in place, such as having the proper fire suppression equipment available during torching operations and good housekeeping in the storage area that David and Lisa have planned, the risk for a fire-related incident would be minimal. And that's signed by Jim Angelo, Fire Chief for Red Granite Area Fire District. And that's it for correspondence.
Anyone in favor to speak or object? Hold. No, you have to fill out a slip. Yeah. Kyle Frayling.
I'm Kyle Frayling. I've known Dave and Lisa for about 4 or 5 years. I've never seen a problem with the property. They've always kept it up, cut the grass, kept it pretty clean. And it's what he uses to support his family. I don't think he should take away his livelihood.
Okay, thank you. Register only in favor, but not speak. Gina. Okay.
Arnoldson.
Okay. Register only in favor, but not speak. Jessica Steger. Register only in favor, but not speak. Randall Kauke.
Sachaki.
What is? Sachaki. Okay. Bear with us. Our secretary is a little slow. Shorthand here. Register only, but not speak. Stephen Rosine.
And that's the gentleman that wants to speak in favor.
Speak in favor. John Ashcroft or?
John Ashcroft, I think some of you guys know me, I'm Fox Valley Recycling. I think, to me listening, I think it's getting blown out of proportion. He's not, and correct me if I'm right, he's not looking to start a salvage yard. He has customers, he picks the stuff up, he processes it, sorts it. He either hauls it to me, or hauls it to where he works at SATA. You know, he's not, I guess, looking to do a salvage yard, right? You know, so I just think it's, you know, what I got here in Watoma is not what he's looking to do. You know, and I just think people are thinking that's what it's going to end up being, and it's not.
Okay.
You know, just for everybody was on the same page about it, you know. So.
All right. Thank you.
Yep.
Speak in opposition, Patricia Daugherty.
Patricia Daugherty, I live W3665 Blackhawk Ave, just about 400 feet from the McCullens property. We are here tonight because Lisa Rosenthal is asking to be awarded a variance and zoning change. That word award bothers me. There's been complaints about this issue and property for 6+ years. Complaints about the noise from neighbors, complaints about unsightly property, complaints on zoning violations. Finding contempt of court by judge issued $6,000 fine, but awarded them a stay. It seems unfair and unjust that they could be awarded again. We purchased our home in a residential ag area, not in town, not next to industry, not next to intensive manufacturing. All hours of the day and night and weekends, we hear trucks entering and leaving the property, dogs barking when trucks arrive, Just this past Monday, a truck left about 6 a.m. Trucks and trailers also come down Blackhawk Avenue. Loud machine from noise from unloading trucks to crunching and pounding of metal scrap of all types, including vehicles. Very close residents signed a petition against having a salvage yard. Two homes across on E from the McCullen property foreclosed recently. There was a bus to be salvaged on Blackhawk property, which is across from the property in question. The town of Leon's comprehensive plan adopted in 2010 shows all nearby properties to be residential, ag, now and in future plans. Objective to protect and enhance the value of existing housing. Objective to protect existing residential area from incompatible land use and activities. Definition of intensive manufacturing is intended to provide for uses which can exhibit harmful, noxious, and detrimental to surrounding uses. Intensive manufacturing zone is not compatible land use for this residential area, along with being noisy, physical appearance, traffic, etc., which is breaking rules already listed in the general manufacturing zone. Also concerned about pollution of the land, water, and animals. What about the lead and other toxins like antifreeze, oil transmission, etc.? No guarantee to nearby residents of proper disposal of toxic waste. No guarantee of proper inspections and licensing. No fence can contain unsightly junk, especially when stacked up feet high on semi-trailers. Just this week, doors appeared on the pole barn that should have been complied in the 2011 court date. Please no variances, adjustments. Please no zoning change. Hope the county board finds the McCullen property unsuitable for salvaging and it remains residential. Thank you.
Thank you. Speak in opposition, Rick Doherty.
Name is Rich Doherty. I live at W3665 Blackhawk Avenue. She's my wife, so I also live 400 feet from the property in question on County E. The noise is pretty horrendous at times. They may not want to make a salvage yard, however they want to define it. I've got photographs I brought in of truckloads of scrap sitting for days. Some of it, what they call processed, some of it not yet processed. Processing, the sorting does make some noise. They've got a skid loader. I can hear it on my property, in my house with all the windows shut. When they process, they're talking about cutting metal down to, I believe it's 3 foot. They have a machine, which I have pictures and a video of people in this room operating, putting long pieces in one end, short pieces come out the other end. It's very, very loud. I don't know what you call that thing, but it kind of vibrates, maybe saws. It's loud. They have semi-trucks, the skid loader, several other trucks. The bus my wife was talking about was stored on the Blackhawk Avenue property, which they bought when it foreclosed. Because they didn't want that bus to be seen, at least in my opinion, on their County E property, they sort of hid it on the Blackhawk property. They're right next door to me in between my house and the County E property with the scrap that they're talking about. In addition, their property is located in an endangered threatened species zone, and that's exhibit or section 5-6 of the Leon Town 20-year plan. I brought that here just in case anybody wanted to see that. The pole barn was a court stipulation saying it had to be all one uniform color because it was being built from used materials. It now has 5 colors on it in haphazard facet. They never complied with making it all one color. This week they put on, or last week, they put on two new doors on the front. So that's five different colors. They're red doors, by the way. One of my big concerns is that they're going to expand their scrapping operation to their Blackhawk property, which we share a 600-foot line, and be detrimental to my property. They have cut new access from the Blackhawk property right onto County E, directly across from their house. So we've seen them use a skid loader to go back and forth, a forklift. So, and the fact that they parked that bus and they've parked other vehicles on Blackhawk, I'm very concerned that they're gonna move over.
Okay. Time is up. We need to kind of move on here.
So. Okay.
All right, thank you. Speak in opposition, Peggy McCanthy.
Peggy McCartney. My husband Ted is in the room as well. Our property shares a border with the house that the McCullens now occupy, which is the Blackhawk property. It's across the road from the area that's under discussion. We purchased the house on Highway E and the 5 acres just last December. We had looked all over Waupaca and Washera County for a nice piece of land in a quiet area. Shortly after purchasing the property that we live in, which is address N3638 Highway E. We also then bought the 5 acres just to our north that became available so that nobody would build close to us. So now we have kind of a rather large investment in both pieces of property and the home. We were given covenants to both of those properties at the time of purchase, and the covenants don't allow for any of this activity. It's a residential area. We find it disturbing that the county would even entertain the idea of allowing a variance or a zoning charge for a scrapping operation that would be directly across from many acres of residential properties. This type of operation would immediately devalue every residential property in this area, and that's really our concern. And we wonder why the county would want the properties devalued for tax base as well. So quite frankly, there are several areas around this county that are unkept and junk cars and other stuff around, and we were really happy to find this plot of residential area that looked pretty nice and people kept things up, and that's sort of why we chose it. We did not know the McCullens at the time. It was December. We didn't know anything about what was going on that corner. It was, you know, winter. We actually didn't even move into the house until the end of January. So we are here to try and protect our investment and would hope that McCullens would understand that we also worked hard to buy that house and land. We both worked 40 years. Ted's retired. I'm going to retire next year. And, you know, these are hard times, and I understand their need to try to make some extra money. But, you know, if we were to find a hobby that would bring in some extra money, we wouldn't put up a sawmill or a auto repair shop or a performance engine testing facility or anything like that in a residential area. And that is really, I think, what's at stake here, is this is just the wrong place for what they're trying to do. I'm not opposed to what they're trying to do at all. It's just the wrong place. And so we are here hoping that the county upholds the zoning decisions that were made many years ago for this area.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Speak in opposition, Josh Say Cali. Close. Oh. Close for most of the jar.
Josh Sackley.
Like close.
Exactly. Before the town hearing at the town board, I got a small petition of most of the landowners adjacent to it down Blackhawk Avenue and on Twin Lane and some on County Road E. I'd like to have that in the record. I'm aware of the injunction against them for scrapping and salvaging on the property and their history of violations with county zoning. And even with a court-ordered injunction to stop salvaging, they continue to salvage on the property with, you know, disregard for the judge's order. And with a legal permitted scrapping operation, there is going to be regulations that come along with that also, and what's to stop them from, you know, continuing to violate the rules with those permits or zoning. And their property, you know, for their variance application for their setbacks, their property just isn't big enough to meet those. It's not the right area for a salvaging operation on 1.6 acres. I live about four houses down Blackhawk Avenue to the east, and there's that subdivision to the south of Blackhawk Avenue that have they have a list of covenants for all those 12 lots in there, as far as you know, keeping the property residential, you know, and that's kind of what they were trying to do when they split that up, to keep the area residential, and that's protect the residential character, and that's what we would like to continue to do. You know, intensive manufacturing opens a window for, you know, more stuff than just a salvage yard or a scrap yard. And then also, like I've been stated before, the environmental implications as far as groundwater contamination from, you know, any type of liquids or stuff they have from vehicles and that would be involved in their scrapping operation. So I'm in opposition to it, just to keep the area residential.
Okay. Thank you, Josh.
Thank you.
Register only in opposition but not speak. Josh's wife. Melanie? That's the staff comments, please.
Again, for the record, the committee has been furnished with a copy of the site plan and all the data that was submitted for this application. Now I'd like to take this time to explain a little bit about zone changes and then how the conditional use permits relate to them, as we do have a conditional use permit within the zone change application tonight. All defined zones have uses that are permitted outright, along with those uses that may be permitted provided certain conditions are met. And these uses are called the conditional use permits and are within the specific zone for which they're found. But first of all, we're looking at changing the underlying zoning on this parcel. So this is a fundamental change in land use, and it will change what is permitted on the parcel. And then there's the conditional use portion of the application. That means that it's a special exception in that zone that if you have enough conditions placed on it, it can be in that new zoning classification. I want to start by talking about the broader implications of the zone change. The current zoning is AG, or general agricultural. This zone allows for single family residential development as well as general farming operations and home occupations such as dog grooming, sign painting, tool sharpening, and dressmaking. This request is to change the underlying zoning to intensive manufacturing from the general agricultural zone. And this zoning classification is geared towards industrial and manufacturing uses. The permitted uses in the intensive manufacturing zone are fairly intense and diverse, and they include automotive heavy repair, dry cleaning establishments, commercial recycling operations, farm machinery sales or service, machine shops, breweries, and freight yards, to name a few. And it also includes the manufacture, processing, fabrication, packaging, and packing of various products, including cosmetics, appliances, pharmaceuticals, tobacco, leather goods, metals, plastics, wood products, plaster, glass, and furs, to name a few of those. So these uses are usually, although not always, located near major highways or other transportation corridors, and are usually located near other zoning classifications and land uses that are geared towards industrial and manufacturing businesses. As you can see, these permitted uses are quite different than what is allowed in the AG general agricultural zone or the RS-20 residential single family zone for unsewered areas, that are the predominant zones around this property and throughout the town of Leon, for that matter. So I believe it is safe to assume that this change in zoning would be a very big change to what is permitted here. And then this is a conditional use permit within that zone, so it needs to be looked at even closer because it's not something that is permitted in that zone. And remember, conditional use permits are okay in a zoning classification if you can put enough conditions on it so that it still remains in keeping with the surrounding uses and area. For both the zone change and the conditional use permit, it is the landowner's responsibility to provide the information that shows the committee this use and the resultant change in the underlying zone and the conditional use permit contained within that zone change are still in keeping with the surrounding uses and area it is proposed for, and that the conditions placed on it will ensure it will be a good neighbor to the surrounding landowners and will be in keeping with the town's other land uses. Remember that we're looking at a conditional use in a zone change to the intensive manufacturing zone. Once the underlying zoning is changed, all of those uses that are permitted in that zone will now be permitted on that property. And that changes and permits such as those are something that goes with the land. It's not something that's specific to the landowner. So if the CUP is granted along with the zone change, a salvage yard can be operated here by anyone. These changes go with the land and are not something that is granted to the landowner only. Please remember that. Also, the rezoning of property needs to be looked at from a wider perspective. The rezoning, if considered for approval, should be beneficial to the community at large and not just the landowner requesting the zone change. If it is only beneficial to the landowner making the request, then it is really considered to be spot zoning, and that's not a legitimate reason to rezone the property. And finally, any decisions of the Planning and Zoning Committee must be in compliance with the town's land use plan. The town board has taken no action on this application, and currently the efforts to rezone the property are not in compliance with the town's land use plan. The applicant would have the opportunity to petition the town to consider whether this should be an area that has changed in their land use plan to accommodate this and other industrial or manufacturing uses in this area. And then it could be reconsidered by this committee if the town board finds that there is a change their planning commission recommends and the town board subsequently approves. However, until that is done, technically the Planning and Zoning Committee should not make a decision to change the zoning when the land use plan does not coincide with this finding. I also did look at what the county land use plan said about economic development related to commercial and industrial land uses, and it said commercial and industrial land uses should be located in areas that are compatible with adjacent land uses, minimize environmental impacts, and utilize existing infrastructure. Additionally, industrial and concentrated commercial land uses should be situated in areas, if possible, where public sanitary sewer and water are available. Now I want to describe the procedure for a zone change. Remember that a zone change is a permanent change to the property, and that by changing the zone, you are changing what is permitted on the property. And because of this permanent change, the review standards are quite high, and applications for zone changes are reviewed by three bodies before they become final. The first step is tonight at the public hearing, and then the Planning and Zoning Committee would make a recommendation on the application. That recommendation would go to the full County Board of Supervisors, and then if approved by both Planning and Zoning and the County Board, the Town Board would review the application and make their decision on it. In order to change the zoning on the property, the application must be approved at all three levels of review, from this committee to the County Board to the Town Board. When the committee visited the property, they noted that the landowners are currently operating the salvage operation, the hours are mostly evenings and weekends, that there is a subdivision and many residential properties nearby, and that a variance would be necessary because setbacks cannot be met. And one other note that I did make is that according to the definitions in our code, this definitely meets the definition of a salvage yard. This is not a recycling operation, this is a salvage yard. When you actively dismantle objects, whether they be autos or other things, that is a salvage yard. So this is the right zone change and the right conditional use for this property. And that's it for my comments.
Okay, is there anything that the applicant would like to add? You have 3 minutes.
We did this while they lived there. They came and introduced themselves after they moved in, said they had absolutely no problem with what we were doing. Absolutely none. The bus was on my property because it had trailer problems. I could not pull it down the road without killing somebody. I knew I couldn't take it to that house, so it parked there till we fixed it and I moved it. I want to see the pictures of this machine that Richard has because it does not exist. Yet, I keep getting videotaped and pictures taken up, and he says that zoning tells him to do it. I'm sick of being harassed. I mean, he sits on the corner. He sits everywhere. It's like he's stalking me. I've had enough of that. As for his thing for clearing the stumps for residential, or, you know, the path, when I bought the house, the guy had it logged, and it was a mess. I had no choice but to dig stumps and clean it out. I'm not making a path from one house to the other. I'll put up the 8-foot fence so nobody will see it. There's other salvage areas. I mean, there's one on the other side of town, on the other side of Pine River. I mean, so it's not the only one out there. There's car businesses. We're not the only business out there. And their land use, whatever they think is going to happen or whatever, however you say that, it hasn't happened in years. So obviously, I mean, we're residential on one side, and where I am, it's all ag, all the way around me. Josh has a petition of a few people. I know you have a copy. I have 104 to 105 signatures of people in the town of Leon that don't care what I do. I even have on here all adjoining properties. Gary Katanch owns one side. Dana Eby owns the other side. I live in the house on one side, and I can't remember. Tom, somebody lives in the log cabin, has no problem. As for noise, I can't. I live across the road. I really have to listen for the skid loader to run. And I'm directly across the road, so how Richard hears it from behind me, I don't know. I'm trying to make this legal. I know I haven't in the past. I didn't know I could rezone. You know, so I've been fighting with zoning for years, yes. But I didn't know I could do this. So I'm trying to do it the right way. The area has been big enough for what we've been doing because it's small and it's sporadic for years. So it's not like, you know, you have to have a big parcel of land because I'm not doing that much. It's been ag zone for years, and on the other side of the road it is residential. But that whole side of the road, all the way up the road, has been ag for years. You don't have to worry about the groundwater because there is no cars. I mean, obviously you're going to lose a little bit, but farmers, you know, you go out in the field and you blow a gearbox, they're going to put stuff in the ground too. You got snowmobiles, they're going to make noise. I mean, it's life. You know, people make noise, people do stuff. You have to rezone. I mean, it's just a hobby that we have. We have to rezone according to Sheriff County Code, intensive manufacturing. And that scares a lot of people. But we just have a little itty-bitty business that is so sporadic. You know, we come and we go. We don't worry about what anybody else is. With an 8-foot fence, nobody's even going to know what we're doing. You know, I mean, we've done it for years, and I'm just trying to do it the right way. You know, so either you have the mess all in one central location with an 8-foot fence, or you have people with stuff scattered everywhere because they don't know where to take it. They work and they can't get to a recycling center to get rid of it. So they call us, we come pick it up, clean up the township.
All right, thank you, Lisa. Okay, that concludes the applications for the planning and zoning. We will now meet in the room to conduct the rest of our business meeting in 263, which is just outside the door and to the right. And the Board of Adjustments will meet here next.
Good to hear. How's it get my down payment in?
I insist on it.
You're like my wife.
Yeah.
here we go. I will call this meeting of the Washera County Board of Adjustments to order. This meeting will be conducted in the same manner as the applications heard by the Planning and Zoning Committee. Please remember to keep your comments brief and relative to the matter at hand. The same time limits will apply to testimony, which is 5 minutes for the applicant outside of the committee questions, and 3 minutes for other testimony, including any rebuttal by the applicant. Anyone other than the applicant or their representative wishing to speak at this hearing must have registered. Anyone who has not should do so immediately and submit the registration slip to the zoning administrator. The committee has looked at all of the properties and a record will reflect these observations. Following the public hearing, the board will conduct their monthly business meeting, at which time we will vote on the applications, and we'll do that right here. We will not go in the other room. You may stay here and hear how the applications are decided, or you may leave following the public hearing. Any person affected by an administrative decision of this committee has 10 days from the filing of tonight's decision to file an appeal. Such appeals are heard by the Washera County Circuit Court. Information on appeals is available from the Clerk of Court's office and qualified legal counsel. The county assumes no liability and makes no warranty as to the legality of any construction commenced prior to the expiration of this 30-day period. I will now introduce the committee. To my left, Larry Tim, Mark Schumacher, John Cirque, Dave Williams, and I'm Kevin Fitzgerald. The first item on the to be considered by the board tonight is a variance. Eric and Mary Ellen Sober, 2014 Revocable Trust, Pewaukee, Wisconsin, has made application for a variance in accordance with Section 58-104, Paragraph 2 of the Washera County Zoning Code to construct an 18 by 30 one-story addition to an existing single-family dwelling, which exceeds the approval of two previously granted variants in the RS-20 single-family residential zone within the Shoreland area. Location: an approximate 0.80-acre parcel of land known as Lot 1 of Certified Survey Map 993, being located in Sections 28 and 33 of Government Lot 1, Township 19 North, R11 East, Town of Mount Morris, Johns Lake, West 6445 Buttercup Avenue. Are the applicants here? Come on up. Thanks for being here.
Eric Sover. And
state your name for the record,
Eric,
please.
Eric Sover.
And would you just like to tell us a little bit about what you plan to do?
So we've been on the lake since 1991, and that's when Mary Ellen's folks bought the place. And in 93, I think he did a room addition. And in 2007, we put another addition on, or we did a remodel of the house, which didn't change the footprint. The house happens to be closer to the lake than any other ones, but we could not control that. But we had a variance at that time to just do an internal remodel with no change of the footplate and at footplate of the property. And at that time, we also put in a shoreline restoration. We added gutters for water protection. We had an irrigation system for water protection. So that being said, we're now, our family is growing, and we'd like to put on an addition, which includes a bedroom.
Okay. I just got some few questions, and we'll ask you, and we'll try to get you through them. Has there been a recent survey?
The most recent survey probably was when our neighbors next door, the Dudgeons, moved in, which was within the last 3 or 4 years.
You know where the lot lines are? Okay. And you have two other variances, correct? And you explained what additions you had done and when already. Do you know why you need to go through this variance?
We need to go through the variance because there's been two previous variances. And from what I understand, the 2015 laws, where we're putting the addition, it doesn't encroach on the current proximity to the lake, and but 150 square feet of the addition will be within the 75-foot allowed distance from the lake to where the addition will be. But current standards allow 200 square feet, so according to 2015 laws, apparently we would be within code. But we had these two previous variances, so we needed a request a third one.
How will you deal with erosion and stormwater runoff with the new construction?
There will be gutters for water maintenance again.
What time, what type of foundation?
There will be a crawl space, concrete foundation.
How far above the existing grade will the first floor elevation be, and how much filling and grading will be done?
It's the same level. there's not a second story. It's one level, one story.
What will the finished height be?
I don't know. You've got the plans.
Would be any higher than the existing?
It will
structure?
Not. No, it will not be higher than the existing home. It'll be lower, slightly lower, I believe.
Any other improvements plan?
No, not at this time.
We've heard that before.
Yeah, no, this is it.
Okay.
What? All other setbacks be met?
They will.
What about the septic system? Is it sized adequately for the home with the addition, and is it near the addition?
Yeah, it's where it has been, and it's been looked at, and it's been up to code, so I think it should be fine.
We just got to look, because it was approved for a certain size bedrooms.
Three bedrooms.
What will this be?
Well, this will be the fourth bedroom.
Okay. Are there any other options to consider where you wanted to put this?
Really not, because we can't go to the west of us. It's too close to their property. And just the layout of the property allows us to just really put it going east.
So you're saying that's what the hardship and unique property limitations that would support this? Are there any other non-conforming structures on the property? Did you put the shed up?
Shed was up.
You put that there?
No, it was
that
up
was there.
When we moved in.
We don't know if it's too close or not to the lot line.
That was put in. I mean, that was there before I moved in.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, actually, we. My father, they were there when your dad moved in. I mean, he moved in 1991, and it's been there since, and it's, yeah.
We all agreed you did a nice job on the shoreline. When did you do that?
2007, 2008.
You know what permit, if you're approved, do you know what permits you'll need?
I don't, but Dave Sherwood does. Sherwood.
Stop in here at the office, they'll help you. If an approval is granted, when would you start building?
Soon, within the next month, if the weather permits.
Yeah, weather permitting as soon as possible, huh?
Yes.
Any other questions, Dave, on the end?
No, I think it's important to note that, yes, the shoreline revegetation was nice to see and exceptional. That your view corridor was within the standards, and it was nice to see that like it is. Really was, and the stormwater management is better because of that, and the gutters that you had, I liked seeing that as well because of the proximity to the lake.
John, anything? Mark?
Nope.
All right. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Correspondence.
The only correspondence that we have is from Leslie Eisenberg, who happens to be an archaeologist with the State Historical Society. And I contacted her. She's actually been up here before. I actually met her once. And she asked that I send pictures of what the board felt they wanted to make sure it wasn't an Indian mound, rather than proceed. And so and I had sent her pictures, and then she looked at it, and then she had someone else look at it, and she sent me this email, and then we actually talked about it a little bit too. But she said, "Terry, we are not convinced that this is a Native American mound. However, if you thought it was, you could hire an archaeologist," and she provided a link to that of qualified archaeologists for your reference. But part of it, when we talked about it, is she said the side that where the addition is going to go certainly looks like a mound, but if you go, you know, to the other side, it's like a ridge that runs all the way to the next house, and then it's level as you get away from the lake. You know, it obviously drops down there, but it wasn't a mound on all sides. So they did didn't feel that it was something that needed to be pursued any further.
I'll just explain to you why we were concerned, because the house a couple doors from you, we were there for a variance within the last couple of years, and there was a mound problem. So we knew there were mounds in the area there, and that's why we wanted to check to be sure.
I just wanted to know why we looked at it that closely.
Yep. And that time when we contacted them, they came right up. So that to me meant a lot as to whether they thought it was or not. And when they said, no, we're not going to come look at it because we don't think it's a mound, I was pretty convinced that it wasn't. So that's it for the correspondence.
Staff comments.
For the record, the board has previously been furnished with a copy of the site plan and all the other pertinent data for this and the other applications that they will be considering tonight, and they also visited all the properties and viewed the proposals at their location on site. Now I'd like to explain a little bit about variances, just because we go through so many applications, I think people need to hear exactly what they're about. And variances ask for a relaxation of a dimensional standard in the code. The decision to grant a variance must be backed by substantive reasons, which include, number one, that the code is unnecessarily burdensome, and that the landowner is not able to enact a permitted use without a relaxation of the dimensional standard. Two, there are unique limitations on the property that prevent the landowner from meeting the required dimensional standard. And three, if the variance is granted, no harm will be done to the public interest or the zoning code. It is the applicant's responsibility to present the case and provide the burden of proof as to why the variance should be granted. Personal situation of the applicant, financial hardship, convenience, a growing family, or nearby violations cannot be considered as valid reasons to grant a variance. When the board visited the property, they noted that this construction could be done under today's shoreline zoning standards if the previous variances had not been granted. And I would add that there is a provision to allow 200 square feet closer than the required water setback, but you would have to do mitigation. So that would be the only caveat to it is permitted, but you would have to do mitigation. That the shed along the east lot line may not meet setbacks. There is floodplain along the lake on this property, and I would also note that I did overlay the floodplain zone on the aerial photos, and you can see that the roof of the house is outside of that floodplain line, and that there may be a protected Indian mound on the property, which now we know is not necessarily what that is, because they did not feel that it was an Indian mound. And one other thing I made a note of here is that the septic system, because you're going to a four-bedroom home with a three-bedroom septic system, if the board did approve it, we would need an undersized system affidavit just to let other people know, should you ever sell it, that the home is now a little bit bigger than what the septic system is sized for. And that's it for my comments.
I have a question for Terry. You said that under current shoreland zoning, this addition would be allowed, but it would have to have mitigation. Okay, would it require more mitigation than what the landowners have already done? In other words, if we would approve this, are we going to have to require additional mitigation?
Well, we don't do prescriptive mitigation. They could pick their point, so having a shoreline restored would be 2 points. Good septic system is 2 points. No non-conforming structures within the water setback is 2 points. And putting gutters and downspouts on it is 2 points. So no, they would actually already meet it. They would just have to document that they have met.
So if we would approve it with those things that they've already done, they would not need to do any more mitigation.
Okay.
Thank you.
Any rebuttal, anything? Okay. We'll go to the second item on our list here today. Ray and Nancy Honnell, Wathoma, Wisconsin, Pearl Woodworth Estate landowner, excuse me, have made application for a variance in accordance with sections 58-542, paragraph C, paragraph 2, 58-823, paragraph C, paragraph 1, and 58-826, paragraph B of the Washera County Zoning Code to construct an approximate 32-foot by 48-foot two-story single-family dwelling. Dimension includes an approximate 21 by 32 attached garage workshop with an approximate 12 by 22 attached deck, coming to within 7.5 feet of both the easterly and westerly side lot lines, 15 feet required, to within 9.5 feet of the right-of-way of State Road 21, 50 feet required, on a non-conforming lot, non-conforming due to lot width and square footage, in the RS 20 residential single-family zone within the shoreline area. Location: a parcel of land on the northwest shore of Silver Lake, being part of Government Lot 2, Section 06, Township 18 North, R11 East, Town of Marion, Silver Lake, with Silver Lake Road and State Road 21. Will the applicant please come forward?
My name is Ray Honnell, and my wife and I are the owners of the property. But, she's ill tonight, and she won't be coming. So.
And you want to build a house?
I want to build a house on a substandard lot. It's a lot that my father-in-law, years and years ago, stipulated that the girls would get this lot on the lake. And so for many, many years, we always thought that if we ever retired, this would be a place that we could build a home. It's a lot of home for a small lot, I know that, but it's we presently have a home on Lake Origami. It's a large home with a big property, and it's a lot of upkeep and everything else, and mostly for just wanting to downsize our lifestyle and go into retirement and everything else. So it's physically, neither one of us are gonna, we down the road we can see we won't be able to maintain this other property. And my father-in-law, Ken, his father had homesteaded all this land, and his father had built all those little narrow homes along there. They owned that land at one time, and he was a carpenter, and so he would, I don't know, for $1,000 or give it to his friends, and then he'd build him a house down there, and he'd have that work. So there's some 30-foot lot stuff and some very tiny properties there, but it's 50 foot, and we're trying to get as much house as we can on the property.
Okay. So I got some questions for you.
Sure.
We'll try to get through this, okay?
Sure.
Has there been a recent survey?
Yes, I just had one done.
And you're sure the lot lines?
Yes.
And do you know where the road right-of-way is?
Yeah. Yes, we do.
Will there be enough room for parking, particularly off the road right-of-way?
Off the road right away. No. There's 10 foot one side and 9 foot on the other side, between that the house, the end of the house, and the right away.
Have you talked to the neighbors about this?
Yeah, they have no problem.
Which ones?
Talked to Steve Norman. There's the A-frame right next door, and then
that's
Ken.
On the east. Kind of. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, all right. And then Ken is the. That used to be the McNabee property that he bought here a while back, and he has no problem with it either. So
have you talked to the town?
Yes, I did, and they said that it's up to what the zoning board decides.
Talk to the State Department of Transportation.
As far as the right of way for this
being so close to the
No, I don't believe I have. I just assumed that because of what town chairman said, that they'd go along with whatever the town zoning board recommended, and I don't know why.
So it's a no for The town is yes, and the DOT is Department of Transportation.
Is a no.
Okay.
When they brought that new, where that road is right now, that frontage road, there used to be Highway 21 that came right through there. And then when they built over there, they took part of our land. And then my father-in-law's house, where my wife was born, in the house, and they tore it down and they moved on another place. And then my wife, we moved to the house on Urigami, so she's lived there all her life. And now we're trying to live on.
What type of foundation will the home be placed on?
It'll be not a slab, but just footings or whatever. I'm not a builder.
Footings? Slab?
Not a slab. No, it would be...
Crawl space?
Crawl space, yeah. And as far as basement, I don't want to anticipate one, but I talked to a builder that if they can get this approval, he wants to build his Jess Johnson. And he said, well, maybe we would think about having to put something in the ground for your utilities or something, but that's... Because I don't have an approval, I haven't really pursued much on this.
How far above the existing grade will the first floor elevation be, and how much filling and grading is planned?
Well, to comply with, on the east side of the property, it's pretty low over there, but that's when Steve built up his property, and we'd like to kind of, as long as we have a small indentation there, we get runoff, doesn't run onto his property, but it's not a great deal of fill involved. We have a lot of runoff that comes off the adjoining property, and if you've been out, you saw that where the lot was very washed out.
Yeah.
Every time it rains, it comes off of his property and off of ours and just rushes down into the water.
So, you don't have permanent plans yet, or any plans yet to tell us how high the first floor elevation will be then?
Well, it'll be, I believe it's going to be a normal home, 8-foot walls, and so how do you figure that? The total structure is less than 25 feet, so.
Your site plan shows 27 feet.
Does it? I didn't know. I didn't
for the finished height?
But that is,
yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
That is something that I drew up, and I'm not much of
okay.
a architect, so it's, and I've also put in these are the maximums that I would use. This is not my finished plan. And the second floor, I just ran it up straight up, and I doubt very much if I would do that.
Okay.
But it's, I've got on the first floor, I've got the way it looks right now, I've got about 825 foot of living space on the first floor.
Okay.
And the second floor, about 1250, 1260.
All right.
Those are numbers that.
Let's try. Let me just answer the questions, and then maybe what you're talking about will be
okay.
in there. Okay.
All right. Fine.
How will you deal with the potential for erosion and stormwater runoff of such a large home on such a small lot?
Well, I don't know if there'd be a lot much runoff than what there is right now. We'd have to mitigate that and level that land and try to find some way in order to. It's like next to. They just did a new mitigation. What do you call it? Is that the word mitigation, or when you put
shoreline restoration?
Shoreline restoration. That's a better word. From Ed from Moose End did it just next to Steve's house, and they brought that out to the same place. He doesn't have that off anymore. But when I fix that shoreline that we've got, I anticipate the same thing. Now I don't know about. I haven't talked to builder what we can do about keeping his water off of our property. And
so we don't really know what you're going to do with gutters or rain garden or more fill or leveling to stop the erosion and stormwater runoff. So
we
don't know that yet.
We certainly wouldn't allow it. I mean, we're not going to we're not going to put all that money into the restoration and still have it wash out. I mean, there are ways to, I don't know if we even would use gutters, tell you the truth. I'm not sure.
Besides the house, any other improvements planned?
Other than the shoreline, no.
Will all your your setbacks be met, and we know that can't be done, right?
No.
You're going to meet the water setback.
The water setback is the only one that, that we've got. It's 35.
You'll be on sewer, right?
Yeah. The lateral is in on the corner of the property at this
time. Shoreline restoration, you're talking about doing that already, right?
Well, that'll be done as soon as I'm in the process. If I get plans and I got to go ahead with this, it would be, I probably have to do that in conjunction with building so that we don't have a lot of, I don't know what the process is. My builder would probably tell me what I would do. I'd work with the DNR, whoever takes care of that.
Right, here's a question for you. Have you considered other options, such as building a smaller home that comes closer to meeting the setbacks?
Yeah, we have, but it's just, there's a certain, I need a two-car garage, number one. It's just, I can't, and in order to have a two-car garage in that house and still have a certain amount of living space, which would be just a kitchen and a dinette and a living room or a great room or something, that's all that leaves me. And then the two-car garage, which is, you know, even if I made a one-car garage out of it, it still doesn't satisfy the length of the building. You know, it would.
What are the hardships?
Hardships are the size of the lot.
And unique property limitations which would support this.
Pardon? What? I don't.
What are the hardships and unique property limitations which would support this?
Well, just the size of the lot. I mean, it's what.
You know what permits you'll need?
Well, I'll need, I'm sure, building permits or whatever. I assume that my builder, if this is
approved. You're willing to find out if it would be approved?
Yeah, it's hard for me to go ahead with anything definite until I find out what I can do and what I can't do, so.
If you were granted approval, when would you start building?
Not till next summer. I need to sell my house.
Any questions from Dave on the end, John, Mark?
Yeah, according to my calculations from Pat Creer's survey, the lot is about 5,000 square feet. Roughly it's 50 feet wide, and then it's 95 feet to the pipe, but then it's another like 15 to the water. So it's about 105 by 50, so a little over 5,000 square feet.
Yep.
And then the house you're planning, you said the first floor has got about 825 square feet living area, and then the second would have, give or take, about 1,250.
Yeah.
And then the size of the house is 32 by 46, right?
Well, one side of it. The other side is because we have a dinette that kind of juts out, and so that we could.
Oh, the other side would be 48. Yep.
48 and 46.
Yep, I see that. Okay.
Yep.
All right. Thank you.
All right. Anybody else? Correspondence.
We have an email from DOT addressed to Lindsay. We have reviewed this and we have no concerns. The town will be the permitting authority. Let me know if you have any questions. Thanks. And that's signed Kelly Nicholas, Access Management Coordinator. And the permit she's talking about, obviously, is the driveway permit received on November 5th. And then we have a letter from the neighbor to the west, Ken and Ann Schlimgen, to the Washera County Board of Adjustments. As the property owner directly west of the Honnell property, we would like to support their request for a variance. The Honnells have always been very good neighbors. Even without a livable building on the property, Ray has always kept the property maintained. We have enjoyed them so much, we even offered to sell them property. We are asking that Ray and Nancy's variance be approved and allow them to become a full-time neighbor. And that's signed Ken and Ann Schlimgen, received on November 16th. That's it for correspondence.
Staff comments.
Again, remember the board has looked at this property and reviewed all the materials submitted. We're looking at a relaxation of dimensional standards in the code, as well as building on a non-conforming lot. And we have have those three criteria to meet, that the code is unnecessarily burdensome. There are unique limitations on the property, and the variance, if granted, would not cause harm to the public interest or the zoning code. One other thing that I should probably add that doesn't come up all the time is that the board is also supposed to grant a minimal relaxation. If you feel that a relaxation of the code is necessary, it is the board's responsibility to look at granting a minimal relaxation. And again, it's the applicant's responsibility to present the case and provide the burden of proof as to why the variance should be granted. When the board visited the property, they noted that the property was well staked. There were concerns about the amount of impervious surface that would result from the placement of such a large home on such a small lot. And as far as my comments go, I guess I too have concerns about this project. It appears to me that the size of the home is being dictated by the personal situation of the applicant rather than the conditions and resulting limitations of the lot itself. It is obvious to me that in order to enact a permitted use on this parcel, that a variance will need to be granted. But it's not as obvious to me that this much relaxation is necessary to build a home. And I would suggest that other plans for a home with a smaller footprint be considered. Unfortunately, it is not the job of the Board of Adjustments to design a home for the landowner. However, this board has routinely asked landowners to meet side yard setbacks if it is at all possible, or at least make an attempt to meet them by adjusting their design to fit the lot. And they have always tried to have people park vehicles off the road right away for safety reasons. I believe that the applicant could come up with a home design that is further from the side lot lines and possibly further from the road right away that would still be livable and suit their needs. And unfortunately, if they can't do that, maybe they really should look at a larger lot. It's not a pleasant thing to have to tell someone, but sometimes the house you want and the lot you have don't exactly match. I certainly understand the personal interest and sentimental value in this particular lot for this particular landowner, but state and county variance standards do not allow that the personal situation of the applicant be a swaying factor in deciding variances and reduced setbacks. And that's it for my comments.
Ray, anything you want to come back and speak or rebuttal? Okay. Thank you. We'll go to the third item to be considered by the board tonight. Number three, Lisa A. Rosenthal, Red Granite, Wisconsin, has made application for a variance in accordance with section 58-236, paragraph 6, paragraph A, and paragraph D of the Washoe County Zoning Code for operation of a salvage yard. Zoning change pending planning and zoning committee consideration. Coming to within 151 feet of a public road, 600 feet required, and with zero side, rear, and fire break setbacks, 100 foot required. In the AG General Agricultural Zone location, an approximate 200 feet east and west by 240 feet north and south portion of an existing 1.86 acre parcel of land known as Lot 1 of Certified Survey Map 4825, being part of the Northeast One Quarter of the Northeast One Quarter, Section 21, Township 19 North, R12 East, Town of Leon, North 3693 County Road E. Lisa? State your name again, please. And tell
yeah,
the
married
here.
Or maiden name?
I know.
Lisa A. Rosenthal.
But can correct it. Go ahead.
It's Lisa McClellan.
Okay. And tell the board why you're requesting the variance.
Because I don't meet the setbacks from the road.
Okay.
I don't have that much property. Although where the 151 foot meets is where a court ordered shed has been placed. I was court ordered to put that shed on that property, so that's kind of where it needs to start. And then, obviously, the back is where the back of the property is. I don't meet the 100-foot fire lanes, but I am surrounded by all farm fields. And when I talked to the fire chief of Red Granite, he said because it's all fire fields and it'll be fenced in, and if we use the right fire suppression equipment and everything when we're torching, he don't see an issue with fires.
Okay. got some questions here for you.
Okay.
I'll try not to repeat the ones that you answered for earlier on. About the fencing, is there any fencing anywhere on the property at this time?
There's some block fencing.
Have you contacted DOT and the DNR, and are you aware of the permits and requirements they may have on you?
I guess tonight I learned that the DNR might have something, but when I talked to the DNR before, but they were more fire.
And what processes do you use to salvage and recycle different materials?
We torch them, take it apart with tools, or use a sawzall.
In the earlier hearing, they asked about automobiles, and I'll ask that question again. Do you plan to handle automobiles
No.
there? And you will dismantle the stuff at this site and store it there?
Yes.
And then transfer it to another facility?
Yes.
Had you handled automobiles in the past?
Long time ago. It's a pain, and we can't, even if a class 4 salvage license, not everybody can do it anymore, so it's not even possible.
And the proposed fence is going to be 8 feet high,
mm-hmm.
and it's indicated on your site plan.
Mm-hmm.
And we asked this when we visited the property, but it's going to be new material.
Yep.
And all the same color.
Mm-hmm. It's going to be white.
Where on the property are you planning on doing the storage of materials?
Within the fenced in area.
Yeah.
I mean, most of it is, like, you guys were there, behind the little white garage in that area. Not so much, I mean, some stuff by the shed, but most on the other side. There wasn't much stuff.
To the west of the property?
The north, it would be.
The west of the little white garage?
Yeah.
Now we're thinking the same.
I can cross that question off because you said you're not going to have any cars on the property, right? You said you were going to take in appliances in the earlier testimony for the other board. Are there chemicals, refrigeration lines in those, and how would you handle any chemicals that would be in those appliances?
Well, we don't set them up. We haul them in. You want to talk about this?
Come on up. State your name for the record, please.
I don't know.
My name is David McClellan.
Freon
bearing appliance.
First name, please.
David.
Go ahead, Dave.
Freon bearing appliances. If anybody has tampered with lines or anything on them, I cannot accept them. So if they are intact, we can handle them and transport them. If we damage them, then I have to have somebody come certify them and everything else in order to salvage them.
You have to be certified to handle them? Only to remove the freon. And you're not planning on removing the freon?
No, I am certified to do it, but I do not plan on doing it.
Okay. Are there any fire dangers or other hazards associated with your operation that this board should be aware of?
Running a torch, but that you just use the right equipment and you're fine.
You want to explain the noise that your equipment will make for this board? What kind of trucks bring the salvage materials in? Are they DOT equipped for backing up for the warning signal? How will you protect the neighbors in a public road from any potential harm that might come from this operation, including fire danger, fumes, spills, increased traffic, or chemicals?
This is the first barrier. I have spill kits to take any spills of any kind, take care of them.
In your earlier testimony, you said that it'd be by appointment only. So you will not have any regular working hours? What would be the earliest and what would be the latest you would accept?
7 a.m. to 8 p.m. at night.
Will you you'd be able to keep a perimeter that is free of vegetation and other combustible material around the property? What is the maximum buffer width you could provide and still maintain enough work area for your proposed business?
Side, we probably could go up 20 feet.
Do you have any suggestions on how to protect the neighbors and public from any potential dangers and nuisances as an alternative to the required setbacks?
I think the fence will help muffle the noise. I mean, if that's what they're most worried about. And we don't really have many chemicals on the property, so that, you know, I mean, we don't handle the car, so you don't have the antifreeze and the oil and the, you know, the stuff that's going to harm the ground.
Now, the proposed fence is going to be 10 feet to the south of the existing shed, right? Okay.
10 feet.
And is that your lot line?
The south side, yes, it is.
So the lot line is 10 feet from the shed. Okay. And that's where you're putting the fence. Okay. So there's no, you can't, there's no wiggle room there. You can't move it for unless you move
actually,
the shed.
There's actually going to be a gate at the end of that because I drive my semis around the shed. That's the only reason I moved the fence out 10 feet. So I didn't have to swing around the fence. I could stay within the fence to drive the semi alongside the shed.
Actually, that's something that wasn't real apparent when we were out there, but when the Planning and Zoning Committee met, there isn't really going to be a fence all along the south side of the building. It's going to start at the end, at the west end of the building, and go out 10 feet and go back further. So actually, okay. Right next to the building, there won't be a fence at all.
But the building will be the screen.
Right. Yeah.
And you won't have anything stored in that 10 feet because you're going to be driving through there.
Semi parked there or a hopper bottom or a trailer.
But no recyclable or salvage materials. Okay.
Do you have adequate room to bring large trucks and semis onto the property to pick up the materials? Will there be parking on the road? Is there enough room to turn around on the property with vehicles? Including large semis. Would there be any backing of vehicles onto the county road? Have you considered other options such as purchasing land in another location where the setbacks can be met?
For so many years and we now own two properties in the town of Leon.
Lisa, this question, since you're the person that's on here, what are the hardships and unique property limitations which would support this?
Well, it's A, not big enough to meet any of the setbacks. I have that shed on the property. That's why I try to keep the business there because I do have a lot of expense in building that, you know, to store the stuff and whatever. So I guess that's my biggest thing, but the property's not big enough to meet the setbacks itself.
Thank you. And one last question. Have you been operating inside the building already? And if so, for how long?
Yep. The building's been up.
And when did you put the building up?
2011, I think. That's a guess, but I'm somewhere around there.
Okay. Questions from the board? Mark?
Well, you know, usually when we have a intensive manufacturing zone change request, people start looking at industrial parks or, you know, in this case, we're not considering the zone change, but we are considering the setbacks. And, you know, the first thing that comes to mind is if you can't meet the setbacks, then maybe you should look for a property that would meet the setbacks. And, you know, so far, the only arguments that I've heard to justify granting a variance is that because this is your property and this is where you want to do it, which I understand, but that doesn't meet the requirements of hardships or unnecessarily burdensome. It just says that this is my property and this is what I want to do with it, and if it doesn't fit, you know, I need to get a variance. We have to look at other alternatives, and one alternative is, could you locate someplace else?
Somebody's gonna pay us for that shed, sure we will.
Well, that's not for this board to decide.
But I mean, that's why, you know, we didn't realize all this when that, you know, we were ordered to put that shed up. So, I mean, we do have a large investment in it that we were totally, you know, we didn't never realize, you know, as long as it was done inside the shed, we were told we could do it, so we put the shed up, and now we're kind of stuck with a very expensive shed on a property that doesn't meet other requirements that we weren't ever aware of.
Okay, Dave, anything? John? Correspondence.
Do you want me to reread?
Yes, thank you.
My conversation with Chris Sorensen, or did you hear it the first time and that was good enough?
I would read it for the record.
Okay. So on October 30th, I talked to Chris Sorensen, the town chair, and again, I initially called him to make sure that he was aware of the relationship between the town's land use plan and the decisions of the county planning and zoning committee. And as it stands, the town's land use plan does not note that this area is slated for future manufacturing, industrial, or commercial development. And if the Planning and Zoning Committee were to make a recommendation to approve the application, it would not be in compliance with the town or county land use plan. And he told me that the town's planning commission was not currently active because some of the original members had either passed away or moved away. And in order to get it fully populated and organized, the town would need some time to do that. He also noted that the town had not taken an official position on the application, but that he had some personal reservations about the application being located so close to the residential area across the street. In addition, he felt that there were issues with the variances to the setbacks that could be difficult to overcome. And he was planning to bring it up at the November town board meeting and would let me know if the town board takes an official position. And again, he did not let me know anything after the town board meeting. And then the other emails in here are from DNR about the permits. And then there's the letter from the fire chief for Red Granite Fire District.
You furnished us a copy of that.
Those are the same letters we received the other day.
Yep.
And the DNR is the same from the earlier hearing tonight.
No more correspondence, and I'm not sure all these people are still here, but.
Well, you can read their names, and if they're not here, we'll just mention it in the notes.
Speak in registration slip board adjustments, Peggy McCartney?
Cartney.
McCartney, speak in opposition of the application. Rich Doherty, speak in opposition.
They've left.
Patricia Doherty, speak in opposition. Josh, register only in opposition, not speak. Register only in opposition, but not speak. Staff comments.
Okay, for the record, the board has previously been furnished with the site plan and all the data, and they visited the property. We're looking at a relaxation of a dimensional standard in the code. Again, these decisions must be backed by substantive reasons, unnecessary hardship, unique property limitations, and that no harm will be done to the public interest or the zoning code. And again, it's the applicant's responsibility to present that case and provide the burden of proof as to why the variance should be granted. Personal situation of the applicant, financial hardship, or nearby violations cannot be considered as valid reasons to grant a variance. When the board visited the property, they noted that there is currently a semi-trailer truck body being used for storage, which is not in compliance with current zoning laws. that this proposal is adjacent to residential development to the east, that all items suggested to be addressed by staff have not been addressed, but then, of course, we got that right after that, so that has been taken care of, and that the proposed location is highly visible from neighboring properties as well as the county road. I, too, do not feel that the question of circumstances beyond the control of the applicant has been addressed, nor do I feel that there has been enough information given that shows that the reasons for having such stringent setbacks in the code have been addressed or mitigated to the point where the amount of relaxation of those standards being requested should be granted. These standards are in place to protect the health, safety, and welfare of all county citizens and should only be relaxed to the minimum necessary. And they should only be relaxed when absolutely necessary to accommodate a permitted use. And I'm just not satisfied that that level of review has been demonstrated in this case. I would also like to address the comments about a court-ordered shed. I'm really not sure where that comes from. When I look through any of the court orders, the only thing that I can see that relates to a shed is that in the one dated from 2011, it says Lisa A. McClellan agrees to store all snowplow equipment, parts for maintaining snowplow equipment in the new storage shed. The snowplow blades and salters may be stored outside. No salvage material, inoperative vehicles, or parts will be stored outside on the property. And that's the only part that I can see that has anything to do with a court order in the shed. The court order, the way I see it, it did not tell them to build a shed. They had a shed, and it just told them to keep their equipment in it. And I'm also kind of confused on the sheds, too. I know we had talked about the first shed blew down, and then there was a second shed. So I'm not even sure which shed this refers to. So you'll have a chance for a rebuttal. But that's the part that I think has to do with the shed. You know, the court did not order them to build a shed. It just said to use it for storage. So that's it for my comments.
Lisa? Just go ahead. Speak into the microphone. So
from that day, I was ordered to put that shed up because when the first shed went down, I did have to call my lawyer to call Ruth and tell her it went down because it had to be up in so many days and, you know, whatever. I had a time frame to meet and whatever. So I had to call my lawyer. And it's 4 years ago, but I remember him saying something about, and I don't have no paperwork to prove it, so you'd have to pull the court records from that day, but something about as long as we did it inside an enclosed building. Granted, I know I got caught doing it outside of an enclosed building. That's how I got in trouble. But I remember him saying as long as it was in an enclosed building, it would be good. But I was court ordered to put that shut up to put that stuff in there.
Anything else?
Nope.
I have one question. We talked about that there wouldn't be any autos on the property or automobiles or vehicles. But you talked about dismantling. What are you going to dismantle?
It depends. Like when the last time I got in trouble with zoning, we got parts from a canning factory. And they were part stainless, they had electric motors on them, you know, and then they had steel. So if you separate it all and you haul it in different volumes, you get paid different. So that's the dismantling. So we cut the electric motor off, you know, you cut the stainless off, and then you'd haul the steel in. So you don't, that's, you know, the dismantling part of it.
I just wanted to know what kind of equipment. If you weren't going to do autos or trucks or auto bodies, I just wanted to know what you meant, and now I understand.
Okay.
Anything else?
You're not using or going to use that existing garage for any part of this business, that 18 by 32 garage, that's just for private?
Not really, yeah.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thanks.
Anything else? Nope.
Okay. Ruth, do you have anything?
Well, hi, everybody. How are you?
I forgot you were there tonight.
That's because I'm so quiet and
you
can speak it, yes, right? I would just note that the Planning and Zoning Committee decided to table their application until the January business meeting for Planning and Zoning, directing me to write a letter to the town board and asking them to give them some direction as to what their thoughts would be, whether or not they are going to approve a zone change or if they're opposed to it. So no action was taken on the zone change tonight. We've had multiple agreements with Lisa in court, and so there was talk about a shed. I think that I would have to pull the transcripts, and because I can't remember what the judge said last week, let alone what he said 4 years ago. The part about it being inside the building is not in the written stipulation between that was drafted with Lisa's attorney and myself. But there was indications in that stipulation that talked about a shed because she had gotten a land use permit to build a new shed because I think an old one had been destroyed, maybe. Okay. So I don't know. I don't know. I have not reviewed the transcripts from any of the court hearings. We've had a couple of different agreements that have been approved by the court, but I don't know what the judge said. I couldn't tell you that sitting here today.
Anybody else?
Ruth, do you feel it would be precocious or premature? I mean, can the board, are you comfortable with the Board of Adjustment acting independently of planning? I don't see anything that's before the board here that has to do with the town land use plan.
No.
Because we're dealing with setbacks.
You're dealing with setbacks.
That's it.
You have a separate issue from the Planning and Zoning Committee. I guess that if the zone change were eventually denied, there wouldn't be the need for a variance. But if the zone change, of course, were approved, then the variance would be needed. So could you act, sure, if you decided to table it because you wanted to see what happened with the zone change, could you do that? Sure. It's completely up to you. Your decision is not based upon the town land use plan or the town input. That it's based upon what you have in front of you.
And that's why the Planning and Zoning Committee tabled it, was specifically to get an opinion from the township and the land use plan, right?
They wanted me to review the land use plan and come back in January with a copy of it and show it and share it with them. And then they wanted the town board to actually take a position instead of just not, given that they would have the last opportunity. If there was an approval, they would have the last opportunity. And given that there was some testimony about that this business supplements the McClellan's earnings. They didn't want to take away their livelihood without having some input from the town board as to what the town actually felt about it, because it would be impacting their land use plan.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ruth.
Larry?
But any decision we'd make would be really moot if the zone change wasn't approved, right?
Well, the variance would still be valid, but I don't know what the variance would be.
Well, they wouldn't need a variance if there was no zone change.
Right.
Okay. That'll end this part of the meeting, and we'll go into our business meeting. Motion to approve the agenda as published.
I'll second that motion.
Dave Williams, Dave made the motion, Mark seconded.